everyone. It's August 29th. Let's call our meeting to order and start with approval of minutes of the July 25th meeting.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes from July 25th.
I will second them. I was here.
Any comments, changes, corrections?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Annie, do we have any adjustments to the agenda?
I don't have any.
4A, we're putting off until September, please.
Okay.
Sure.
All right. That's it? That moves us right to 4B.
All right. First, we have approval of the recommended changes to the Hopkins Academy handbook. So what you had in your packet was a summary of those changes, and I believe you're also sent under separate cover all the tracked changes in that to cross-reference the summary of changes with the tracked changes. And certainly if you have any questions about those, Mr. Beck is available to answer those questions. As I said previously with the HES handbook, what we tried to do was any place there was information that was duplicated in policies and things that Mr. Beck hands out to all students on the website, we're trying to make this document a little more reader-friendly. We're not quite there yet. It's still well over 100 pages, but we're actually trying to make it into a document that people
read.
Yes, that's the word I was looking for, that people read.
You have high hopes.
I do.
Why did they remove rights and responsibilities of students?
Rights and responsibilities of students is actually probably a misnomer, and if you look at it in policy, it's actually senior privileges. It's just entitled rights and responsibilities, and so they get that at the beginning of the year in exactly the same format that it exists in policy. So again, that's actually a really good example of something else that's a redundancy that can be stricken from there. So.
Do we need to do anything with that?
It's considered a part of policies. You have to.
Any other questions or comments?
No.
Thank you both for doing that. How about a motion to accept it?
Motion to accept the Hopkins Academy handbook with the requested changes.
Seconded.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Thanks, everyone. Oh, we're on 4C. Town meeting request. It's 5:33 and we're already on 4C.
What?
I know.
You're screaming through this.
Great.
So just a reminder that we have special town meeting coming up at the end of October. I don't have the date in front of me and I should. Okay. Somebody else.
October 27th, is that right, Richard? Oh, Donald, yes, October 27th.
Okay.
But we have a fiscal forum before that scheduled with everyone to try to inform the general public all about those warrant articles,
yep.
So we don't have a fiasco at town meeting.
Yes. So the school department is requesting that we restore the $75,000 that was cut primarily to support text and supplies, learning materials that we didn't have to buy immediately in September, but certainly we haven't planned to go without them. The warrant deadline is August 31st. The language is simply the request for restoration of $75,000 to the FY16 budget, and we'll be prepared to answer any questions. I believe there are two public information sessions. I think I sent an email along to you folks, and again, I should have brought, one is in the beginning of September, I want to say around
14th.
September 14th is one, yep. Where they'll be looking at warrant articles, and again, immediately before special town meeting. I'm sure the select board will be posting when those meetings are. We encourage the public to attend, and even more importantly, we strongly encourage the public to come to special town meeting and ensure that the restoration of the $75,000 that was cut from the school department budget is in fact restored.
Questions about that? People have all those dates? I think we did get the email.
Right?
Okay.
Yeah.
Personnel report.
You have a personnel report in your packet. The only position that we currently have, we did receive a resignation. Our occupational therapist has elected for a full-time position in another district. We received that resignation, I think, about the week before school started, so we are working hard. Dr. Wickman and Ms. Bell have been working hard to interview candidates for the position, and we hope to have it filled soon.
I forgot that Dr. Wickman was on our personnel report from last month or the month before. She's our interim elementary school principal. Welcome. Thanks for joining us.
Very glad to be here. Very excited.
You want to give us a little bio? Anything you'd like to share about yourself? I like putting people on the spot, apparently. I do it to my staff all the time. Sorry.
Been an educator in Massachusetts for 36 years. The last 15 of those as an administrator, both principal and 10 years as a superintendent. But now I'm back, closer to the kids and the staff, and really looking forward to the school year. It's going to be a busy, fun one.
Thank you. And we should say thanks for staying with us, Pat.
My pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Okay. We're already on to public comment period. Donald, do you have anything for us?
Not really. Do you catch the thing we're going to have the tri-board meeting prior to the fiscal forum? You're aware of that, right?
Yep. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. We're already on to the business manager report. Man, when we have a deadline, we zip through these meetings, don't we?
We may want to call CPA. So we don't, as we mentioned in your email, in your packet this month, you did not have, typically you receive revolving accounts, grant, and expenditures, and that's because we had not fully rolled over the previous fiscal year into this fiscal year, so the reports would not have been useful to you. I think we're almost to that point, or we have completely rolled it over, and so next month you'll have up-to-date reports and expenditures, grants, and revolving accounts. We do have an item on here, which kind of will connect with CPA, but I wasn't sure if the school committee had any interest, and we can also wait until we're talking about the CPA proposal, but any interest in exploring using some sort of revolving account within our existing accounts if people wanted to donate to the project, if we wanted to fundraise, or if groups wanted to give a portion of the proceeds that they raise on behalf of the schools to this specific project. And I know that Dr. Houle can speak a little bit to what our options could be, and this is meant just to be a kind of a conversation starter and to think about some possibilities.
Obviously, you can always start a revolving account if you need to, using the town's guidelines for doing so. But another option, which might be a little bit easier and cleaner to do, would be to use your current athletic revolving account, just knowing that we would have to have a very tight handle on accounting and tracking funds that would be donated for the purposes of upgrading the fields, and keeping that separate from gate receipts and user fees that would be to fund general operations in the athletic department. So that would be something that we would just have to set
up. So it's basically like an enterprise account within an enterprise account?
Mm-hmm.
I think that makes sense. What's the beeping?
I'm not certain. It could be this fancy new machine that I have.
Yeah.
So is it my fancy new machine, potentially?
I'm sorry, just, you know. Just in case there's a, if there isn't a timeline to that beeping and resulting in anything.
I don't think it's
like
mine.
I think it's coming from there. So I really can't help you with that. But
we had a building inspection today and it went well. So apparently
good.
It's not a big problem.
Okay, good.
The chief didn't have an issue with it, so it went fine.
Do we want to authorize the creation of that? Do you guys like the idea of within the athletic revolving account, or?
I don't think we have to create anything if we use the athletic.
No, we would just track it internally.
So all we have to say is go forth?
Yep. So if donations came in, we would just make sure that we'll set up a tracking system for all of the revolving accounts anyway. So we could do that so that if funds were brought in for that purpose. It seems kind of foolish to set up a separate revolving account, particularly if this is a short-term fundraising goal. That once the goal is done, then you have to dissolve the account, and it just makes it easier from a bookkeeping perspective.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
If I could just make a request for a process that might actually help on both sides, that Eric Sudnick be consulted really throughout, because he'll have an idea of what types of things, how much money needs to be left sort of liquid all the time for the general operations, as Judy said. And he might even be able to target and prioritize things that could be moved forward so that the account could be managed, you know, more effectively.
The only question I have is if people would feel more comfortable donating to something that was specific instead of saying, I'm going to track it.
Would it be helpful if, as part of the reports that the school committee gets, to provide, could we do that? And do you think that would be helpful in terms of transparency to identify?
I'm not concerned about transparency. I'm just saying that if I was going to give a bunch of money and somebody said, we're going to keep tracking that.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. Do you think it'd be enough for the public if it were in the school committee packet and it listed clearly even donations that came in? So they could identify, wait, I gave this amount. So each individual donation didn't have to be tied to the donor unless they requested acknowledgement of the donation. If something were anonymous, they could still track their amount. Right. And even if there was no activity, that we could just include it as part of the reporting. It might also keep people's eyes on the fundraising. Yeah. And they could always go, they don't have to come to school committee. They, of course, people are welcome to. They could just look at it online since it would be in your packet as a piece.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
Okay. Okay.
Judy, the other thing that would be that I forgot to ask you for but thought it was super information was the information that I looked at last week about the 16 to 17 choice differential of revenues coming in and expenses going out.
Sure.
And if we could bring that information to the September meeting, that would be that would be great.
Sure.
And we'll probably bring it in advance of that to Tri-Board on Wednesday, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. The bottom line, good news, is that we are $100,000 to the good, better, with less money going out and more coming in choice between 16 and 17. So that's great.
Mm-hmm. It means you're attracting more students and retaining more students, so all of that's good news.
We have that data on how many more students and where?
Probably.
Yeah. So we can also get you our enrollment data. It's based on October 1 data. That's a snapshot in time that ties then to the money that you receive. So we can provide you with the enrollment data upon which the cherry sheet information that Dr. Hull will bring next time, we can provide you with that and also what we have right now. Is I'm sure I can have DREX run what's right now, which may not tie exactly to last October 1. That's what drives what we're getting in fiscal year 17.
Thank you. Are you good? That's all you guys have for us?
That's all we have.
Wow. Chris was so much more chatty.
I do not want to be late.
Mark and I are short.
All right, we're already on school committee reports. Policy.
You have
second reading?
Yes,
second
that's right.
Reading. A minor changes needed at our last meeting. And, it was considered straightforward last time.
Yeah.
Do you have any questions?
No, the policies look good.
Mm-hmm. That's good because I think one of those policies is in the Hopkins Academy.
Yeah.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. On food. Revolving account.
Oh, so the changes to the food service are just what we talked about last month.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Right.
Mm-hmm.
I had to jog my memory. Okay. So we are looking to endorse JICHEFDA and, please help me, JJF-R. There are my glasses right there.
Make a move to accept policies as amended.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, Policy Committee. Do we have anything outstanding, or we think we're up to date for today?
We think we're up to date.
That will change.
And we agreed to meet quarterly.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Okay. We're on to survey. Is it over here?
Well, funny story about that. I was just on a phone call with people in Germany about a conference call in India, and as in my haste of running out the door, I forgot my adapter for the Macintosh,
which
doesn't make it straightforward to connect. But I can still deliver a presentation.
Yep.
You have handouts. There are
a
few extra copies as well.
Yep.
we'll do it the old-fashioned way.
Okay.
All right. So Heather and I are pleased to present to you the results of the 2016 parent survey. As you know, this is a project that is especially important to me, just collecting parent feedback being an important part of continuous improvement for our district. And since we started doing this, as you may recall, 2014 was the first time we, as a school committee, surveyed parents. Before that, I think there was a paper survey that Nick Young had done, and I think it was 2010. But since then, 2016 has seen quite a few parent surveys. We've had the CPEC, General and Special Education Parent Experience, which had lots of response and produced great feedback. It was presented to the school committee just not too long ago, a couple of months ago. The Athletic Program Review Parent Survey, as well as the Library Survey. So I think this survey came at a time when people were pretty surveyed out, but we got some great feedback nevertheless. On the next page, you'll see how many people did respond. We had 73 people responding to the survey, and you'll see this is how it breaks down. It's 37 from Hadley Elementary, 25 families from Hopkins Academy, and 11 who have students in both. We also have a few differences in the way in which we administered the survey relative to last time we did this. We do get to compare this year's results to 2014, kind of as a baseline. We did reduce the number of questions by half in response to overwhelming feedback that it was a really long survey. So we went down to 34 questions, which took approximately 5 minutes for the for us, our small sample size of testers to take. We also got from that initial feedback, that focus group of testers, that it was really hard for people to respond to the questions as it related to their elementary school experience and the Hopkins experience, and they would really prefer to separate it out, which seemed like a pretty straightforward thing. So we did that, and we now can analyze it by school. And so moving to the next page, you'll see some of the areas where we improved. Specifically, we had some gains in curriculum. People feel informed about the expectations for learning for their children. They feel their children are developing problem-solving skills and higher-order thinking skills. And they also feel as though, on the assessment side, teachers are using a wide variety of assessment methods. On the social-emotional side, parents feel as though teachers and the school is helping people understand the connectedness between social and emotional health and students' academic performance, as well as family-school engagement and communication. Specifically, people feeling as though school personnel respect cultural heritage. And I demarcated where, which school were really driving the increases. The Hadley Elementary School drove a lot of those increases on the assessment side, a variety of methods of assessment. Both schools were kind of equal. And on the respecting personal cultural heritage, Hopkins Academy really drove that one. I think could in large part be to the measures made by the Diversity Club.
Humira, is this a 1 to 5 scale?
Yes, yeah. Like a scale of, so with 5 being the highest and 1 being the lowest. Or strongly agree and strongly disagree. And then on the next page, you'll see the areas that are still in need of improvement. We saw on the school facility side, a lot of people commenting about the facilities in need of upgrade. In particular, we saw this quite a bit on the Hopkins Academy side. On instruction.
Did they provide any, or are we gonna get to open-ended? Was there any specifics on that?
We will get to open-ended. There were some specifics. We weren't able to sort of share all of it because there were a lot of name specifics. We wanted to respect privacy. So the administration has that information, but school lockers were brought up. Just that this facility hasn't been touched in some of the 20 years. I don't know in fact the case. But it really is time for an upgrade is what people were saying. And then on the instruction side, feedback about instructional practices was something that was, we scored poorly on last time, and it went even lower, that people don't feel as though they're asked for their opinions on how the instructional practices are relating to, you know, their son or daughter's actual learning. On the social-emotional side, we saw SPED, issues of special education, come up quite a bit in the open response, and we really saw it in the numerical data as well around staffing for special education, 504s, English language learners, and so forth. And also on the counseling side, college preparedness, on the Hopkins Academy side in particular, people felt as though there could be some room for improvement there. And then finally, there were a number of areas that really mapped to some of the initiatives that we've been undertaking that held flat. So it was heartening to see that those areas held flat. We would have probably liked to have seen more gains. For example, on the instruction side, teachers providing additional support to my son or daughter when needed. We've, as you know, implemented tiered instruction, so we would have liked to have seen more gains, but we're happy to see that it held flat. On the assessment side as well, in terms of school-wide learning expectations and communicating the learning expectations, we've put a lot of effort into implementing EdLine, and parents also talked about in the comments their they're really happy to see EdLine be implemented, but there are some user issues which we are aware of and are making strides with SchoolBrains, purchase of a new software to make it more user-friendly for faculty as well as for parents at home. And then on the social-emotional side, information about safe and positive, respectful cultures, supportive communities, and also family school engagement and communication. With all of our PBIS initiatives, we would have expected to see more improvement there. And then the and with all the recent communication on behalf of the superintendent, Annie, your communication specifically came up in the comments and the open response, people being happy to be informed in that way. And so really looking at ways we could further communication, I think, is an area that we could look at as a school committee. Any questions so far?
It's great.
Okay. On the communication mechanisms, as you can see, people are pretty well aware of open house. Chalk Talk is something that we
this ask, are you aware of it or do you like it?
Are you aware of it?
Okay.
So that people know where they can get their information.
Okay.
And we, so people are quite well aware of Chalk Talk, less at the Hadley Elementary, Hopkins Academy, because PTO is stronger at the elementary school. But we also noticed that the PTO website saw some declines amongst the Hadley Elementary School population, and I know they're trying to recruit more parents. I think maybe beefing up some of the communication strategies could help reach some of the younger generation that's coming in and their parents to both communicate and engage them in those activities. The school phone and email messaging system is strong. People are quite aware of that, although some a little bit of decline at the Hadley Elementary School. School website, teacher emails, less relevant at the Hadley Elementary School is the teacher websites, class pages, but Hopkins Academy parents really valuing those. And then next, the demographics. As you'll notice, the ethnicities stayed mostly the same. We're still predominantly a white community at 88%, and the breakdown between Black or African American, Native American, Asian, and multiple ethnicities is about the same. But what's interesting, on the next page, you'll notice that our income demographics have changed.
I'm sorry, may I just clarify one thing?
Of course.
These are not our actual demographics. They're the demographics of the respondents, which was 76. We don't know how many 76 families, and I can't tell you exactly how many families I have. I can tell you how many students I have. Yes. So at most, about 10%.
So I just want to make that distinction, that this is not the demographics of the community.
Not only is it for those who took the survey, but also those who opted to
answer this. So that's actually not even of necessarily everyone who took the survey.
All the demographics are optional.
Okay, thank you.
On the household income side, another optional question. We'll notice that no one responded that they were in the lowest income bracket, whereas in 2014, people did respond, 7% or so responded they were making between 0 and 24,000. And we see gains in the middle income bracket of 75 to 100,000, which is a good thing. More people are employed this time around. And now the open responses on the Hadley Elementary School side, as we mentioned, there was quite a bit more. There was an emphasis. We saw certain themes. Special education was an important one, and we have plans, as you all know, to with the restructuring of the position of the director as well as the coordinator function. I think we are poised well to address some of those. There are some specific quotes I pulled out for Hadley Elementary School. People were very, there was a lot of praise for specific faculty there. Jeff Udall will be missed as well. Redacted the specific names, but people were very enthusiastic about the level of service they saw from support staff, nursing, custodial, and so forth. On the Hopkins Academy side, we saw quite a few themes around communication and EdLine, and the level of use for EdLine being widely different mm-hmm. from teacher to teacher. Mm-hmm. And so it's a point for us to think about how do we ensure consistency of quality across mm-hmm. the faculty. And then finally, some great Hopkins Academy open responses, and a real appreciation for EdLine, and you know, having wanted this for a while, and being happy to be a part of a great education system, feeling the benefits of a small school culture, and feeling as though their students are being engaged, which is no small feat at the at the high school mm-hmm. level. Mm-hmm. So any questions on that?
No, but it was great. Maybe, and we're doing it every 2 years, trying to do it every year, every 2 years.
That's the plan, for 2 years.
Yeah. Maybe the next time we should try to recognize the survey fatigue, because that's always so hard to get a good response rate when people have been surveyed out.
It is, and you know, now that we know the different areas we want to survey on, maybe we can coordinate better
mm-hmm.
a comprehensive
right.
strategy that that doesn't sort of nickel and dime people for feedback.
Right. But mm-hmm. good information.
Really good. Thank
information.
You.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Very nice helpful for us. Very useful for us too. And things that the school committee have collectively identified as things that we should look
right.
at and we should be addressing. And so this is helpful.
Yep.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Finance and Tri-Board. Heather and I missed the last Tri-Board meeting. There was a posting problem and neither of us could make the reposted meeting. There is another meeting on Wednesday. I met briefly with Molly Keegan to understand what we missed, and what we missed is that there will be a public forum on September 14th that will be kind of our first opportunity to talk to the town about the financial projection of our future in terms of operating budget and capital and the schools. Molly is giving the schools the opportunity to participate, and I said, of course, we would. And so I think the tri-board meeting is talking about preparing for that public forum. My brief thinking about it would be that the school's presentation would be somehow a melding of our PowerPoint that we do every year about the current year budget with the five-year projection work that Chris did just before he left, so that we are giving the town a good sense of how we work financially and then what our projection looks like going forward.
What do you think we need from capital?
Hmm?
What do you think we need from capital? Anything?
Well, we've submitted the our five-year prioritized capital plan, and I have not heard whether there must be a capital planning committee meeting on the town side before a special town meeting, but I don't think I've heard when.
I'm sorry, I don't know. Do you know?
Not sure either.
Okay, maybe we can find that out at Tri-Board on Wednesday. And then the other thing, too, that we talked about already was that the other thing I wanted to show Molly is that Molly at the last Tri-Board meeting was looking at the choice numbers and the charter numbers and was showing that we send out $300,000 more than we bring in, but that was both choice and charter. And, you know, there's several problems with combining choice and charter. Number one, we're competing against two niche schools, the Chinese Immersion School and the Pioneer Valley Performing Arts School. Number two, every student we bring in choice brings in approximately $5,000. Every child we send out to charter is approximately $12,000. And so I told Molly that if the town wanted to give us another $300,000 or more, we could probably better compete with our charter schools.
But we'll start a Chinese program and a theater program.
Exactly.
It'll be a Chinese theater program, actually.
Right.
You'll perform
it's
in
going
Chinese.
To be very specialty.
So if you're not commingling those two things, when you talked earlier about being ahead on school choice, you're not talking about including people who
were
charter schools in those numbers.
And the number that I gave, that $100,000 to the good, is only 16 to 17. But I don't remember, Judy, we are $100,000 better between 16 and 17, but we bring more choice in than we have choice outgoing, but I don't remember the number. Do you?
The town has never looked at those as two separate figures when they've pulled out the numbers and assessed on the cherry sheet.
The town has never separated out choice and charter?
That's right. It's just what the loss is to the town.
Right. All right. Well,
the cherry sheet,
so
fortunately,
I mean,
does.
It's a good thing to bring up now, but that's never been done historically.
Right.
And the cherry sheet does treat them as separate. Which
right.
is helpful.
Yes.
Although,
right.
as you're saying, the town looks at it differently, which is understandable. At the end of the day, they care about the bottom line.
Yeah.
But it is helpful, I think, sometimes for the public to be aware that these are, that in terms of our efforts to retain students, to attract students, the trend is going really well.
Right.
And we are paying out money in charter tuitions, and we have two really specialized in good charter schools right near us. That's not too surprising.
Yeah, the increase from FY16 to FY17 in school choice receiving tuition, according to the cherry sheet, is just a little bit shy of $33,000 additional funds coming in. And on the assessment side, we are about 70,000, just shy of 70,000 of less being assessed from 16 going into 17. Mm-hmm. Now those numbers tend to be a little bit fluid on both ends of it because as numbers change during the course of the fiscal year, those numbers will also change, but we're looking at what was proposed in the FY16 budget, so we're looking at apples to apples to what came out of the conference committee. We've got about $70,000 less going out and about 32, 33 more coming in. Mm-hmm. In the chartered school sending, we're up by about $24,000 going out, and then there's a reimbursement against that, and the reimbursement is up by about $19,000. Coming back in. Your reimbursement is not the full amount that goes out for charter schools. And what the legislature did was, obviously they accounted for more students going out, but they funded it at FY16 levels when it finally came out of the conference committee. So you're probably not seeing as much gain in the revenue coming back in to offset charter tuitions as you might. And although it is about $30,000 less than the governor's original proposal. It's actually more than what came out of each branch of the legislature, so they did up it a little bit.
Yeah. So I think the only last thing to say about that is that one thing I hope to establish at Wednesday's tri-board meeting is that it would be good to have the support of the select board and the finance committee of our five-year projection. And if there are any remaining questions about our five-year projection, I'd like to get those answered on Wednesday rather than not look like we are a united front at the forum in September. And the only other thing to say about that is I think the pre-special town meeting forum is October 20th. I will not be in town, so I will be hoping one or more of you can go to that meeting. I can be at special town meeting, but not the forum the week before.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Just a quick comment on something that transpired at that meeting that sort of left me a little perplexed. We started talking about the municipal fiscal pie, which the school is about 42%. And when you include the benefits, it reaches about almost 50. But Dr. Kilpacky, the finance chairman, made a comment about educational rating. And no one in the room understood it, and the school board wasn't there to defend it. He said the Chinese Emergent School is a 9, Hopkins Academy is a 6, and our elementary school is a 4. Nobody knew what he was talking about, and I still don't know.
I have no idea.
What kind of rating he's talking about.
So there are many, many ways to rate
there's
schools.
There's got to be, but...
I don't know which one he was... I don't know what he's referring to. That would be news to me.
I guess I have to ask him, too, to find out, because...
The rating and criteria.
It didn't sound good. The conversation ended, and that's where everything ended, about the school. So it sounded like the Chinese Emergent School is doing fantastic, and our schools are way behind for some reason. You know, and no one was there to comment on it, and he didn't go further either. So it left me a little perplexed to find out why, so I'll have to investigate it with him, I guess.
Yeah, it'd be difficult for me to respond without knowing the specific rating scale to which he was referring, the criteria used in that rating scale, and then you'd have to ask yourself, are all the variables utilized to evaluate the quality of the education equal in both contexts? So those would be the questions I would have, but I have no idea to what rating he's referring.
Maybe it's a Chinese program. We don't have one, right?
Well, when we get
that
a Chinese
would be a
theater
at
program,
home.
Yeah, it'll be good.
Okay, that's all I've got for Finance Tri-Board, unless there's other questions. Okay. Paul.
Yeah, so I'm looking for school committee approval on a proposal to the Community Preservation Act group, CPA. We're meeting later this evening, and the proposed project is for $15,000 to go out for bid to get full engineering, design, and construction plans for the rehabilitation of all the Hopkins fields. So this would include the creation of new fields, a new baseball field, and a new multi-sports field, which is currently being farmed right now, and then the redoing of the existing men, boys varsity baseball, and then also leveling out the girls softball varsity field as well. So the at the end of this project, so we're asking CPA to fund the engineering and construction design plans. And so at the end, we'd have it all broken out possibly into two, maybe three phases, depending on cost. And we would really have specific information that we could go then start secure funding to do those individual phases.
I would think it important when we, if we get approval for this and we go out to bid for design and engineering, it would be important for us to add to the scope of work of the designer and engineer of specifically what can be done with volunteer labor. Since that is one of the perennial problems we've had with this project is that the price tag comes in from Berkshire Design Group, and we've had people in town say, well, that's because it doesn't include all of the volunteer labor that Hadley could provide. And then I've heard from the designers that It's really complicated grading. So having that specifically addressed in the design would be important, I think, going forward. And I noticed when you sent us this that we, in this proposal, have not put any match for the 15,000. Is that right?
We haven't.
Do you think we need to? What will their response be? We'll find out at 7 o'clock.
Would 15,000 cover the design?
It'll cover the design. I spoke to a few designers, to one, just get an estimate. But what is not included in here is survey work, because there has been previous survey work. That would suffice. I talked to the surveyor. So there has been a lot of work done. Obviously, it's just revising the previous work that's already been done. I think a match would make our proposal stronger.
Hey, is there anything in that account we just set up about an hour ago?
Not yet.
What is up with us?
Could all the survey work that we've done in the past can be considered as
match
and
investment in kind?
I believe we did pay for
design. Yeah. Oh, that's true.
Right. I'm sorry. Would you just say that for me one more time?
I believe we did pay for Berkshire Design. I'm thinking 25,000.
For the previous designs that we had.
I think so.
And they contracted out with.
Is that your recollection, Michael? The survey would be done by.
Right. Is that it?
All right. We'll see how it goes.
May I ask, since you won't be deliberating about this at the next meeting that you go to, but here, so can I, if there's some sort of vote, or this is where you would determine, is everyone in favor of the presentation of this?
I think the big question is, are we in favor of going to CPA just for the design at this point, design and engineering?
Right.
Well, I thought that there really was that was the strong suggestion from CPA, was don't come in asking for notes. That not correct?
Yes, but I get my only pause is that if we have a sense that they will not fund the project after this stage, why go through this stage?
Hasn't been my sense.
I don't know, because I wasn't at the meeting. So.
Well, so my sense is we are going to have to look at reducing costs and doing volunteer and in-kind support for this. And so I think that is what this revised plans are going to allow us to do, break it out into more manageable phases. So I think there's some lessons to learn by what they're doing with Zooteca Park. Mm-hmm. And CPA funded that initial design, and then they broke it out into multiple phases so to make it much more cost-effective. Mm-hmm. I think we can build on that. And so these construction and design plans, engineering design plans, would allow us to then go and do bite-sized pieces that maybe volunteers can do. Mm-hmm.
So this is the procedure on CPA. So it doesn't go on the town warrant unless the CPA accepts it? Or is it something where it goes on the warrant and they can say, yeah, we don't want to support this project, or we do? Do you know how that works with them?
I can tell you my impression, if that's helpful, based on my conversations with the chair.
Yeah.
And again, I want to be clear that no one person speaks for an entire body, so these are just conversations I've had with the chair of the CPA. If I heard him correctly, that they make a decision about what they recommend to the warrant to even be considered for CPA funding.
So it doesn't go on the warrant if they don't approve.
That is my understanding.
I think that is right.
Yeah, that's my understanding.
Kind of makes sense, because they're the gatekeeper for the CPA
thank you
funds.
To them. I think they are in part meeting tonight just to entertain our proposal to meet the timeline, so I appreciate them doing that. Mm-hmm.
So do we need to talk more about matching funds, since that is something that's important to them before?
I think bringing up your idea of bringing up what we've already invested. Mm-hmm. I know that doesn't directly address, we can get more, but at least being on the same page that we've made an investment already.
For this particular phase, if I may, perhaps for this particular phase, because you're asking solely for funding for design, and to your point, to your best recollection, that the previous designs cost approximately $25,000, maybe. And so that is an investment in design that's already been made by the school department. So you have.
We spent some money.
I know we spent a couple of times. So substantial.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you've spent the equivalent of more.
Not just for designs, but also for the surveying, mm-hmm. which we'll be able to repurpose mm-hmm. for this work, right? Because
yeah.
So does it make sense for us to approve some amount in addition in case we have to go that route?
That's kind of what I'm asking.
Okay.
If you want to have any sort of outlaws.
If we have discretion to do so, I think it'd be wise, at least.
So we'll lead with our in-kind, but if we need to, we can offer up how much?
Whatever we're willing from.
Yeah, that's thank you. Yeah, I know. I was just picking up my pen. I'm happy to write it down.
What was budget to be?
Where would we find it?
How far is the money?
Yeah.
I mean, the obvious issue that people will bring up, I suspect, is school choice. Can't you spend some of your school choice money on this? And so what's the answer?
It was brought up at the last CPA.
Mm-hmm. It's a fine.
Then we're trying to get $75,000 back from the town too. It just doesn't seem prudent to be spending from school choice.
I can't agree to do that.
Yeah.
You know, it's too bad that that we are 2 weeks away from the public forum that will show our school choice will be gone in the middle of fiscal year 2018 mm-hmm. if the town doesn't do something.
Right.
And so spending it on the fields instead of on delivery of education seems impractical to me.
I support that argument.
And something just to consider, and I have no opinions about how any other department has or runs a prudent reserve, but just things to consider. So if roughly, although we've talked about this many times, at a single point in time, someone may pull a financial that indicates that there's $1 million sitting in school choice. And that's only because we have not expensed against school choice funds because we put over $500,000 of school choice money toward the operating budget annually. But that leaves us with roughly, let's say, somewhere in the vicinity of $500,000 in prudent reserve. And some people may seem that seems high, but when your total operating budget is in excess of $7 million, you're looking at a prudent reserve that's less than 10%. Mm-hmm. The CPA itself understands the value of prudent reserve. It's my understanding that they voted to have about a $600,000 prudent reserve mm-hmm. for funds that I believe are somewhere around $2 million. Mm-hmm. So their prudent reserve is much closer to 25% of their total monies. And we probably, based on what Mr. Pip had said earlier about our percentage of the municipal budget, our payroll is probably the largest in town. So having a prudent reserve that is actually less than 10% of total operating budget, most auditors would find appalling. And there are other places where the prudent reserve is 100% of funds. There are two enterprise funds in town for which that is the case. That's great. Every department should run their departments in the best way that they see fit. But the idea of having, in our two enterprise funds in town, prudent reserves that are 100% of total operating costs. Another fund that is not an enterprise fund, but a fund where the town keeps its monies that has a 25% prudent reserve and no payroll and no associated expenses. And yet the largest department in town receives a tremendous amount of scrutiny for having a prudent reserve that is less than 10%, again, an auditor's nightmare. It's just something that I think bears looking at.
So I say we go forward with this proposal.
And we are agreed on going forward with this proposal, and we are also agreed that if a request for using match of choice with choice money, we are saying not at this time. We're
because
not comfortable at this time.
Because of the tax that you presented.
And citing prior investment, which if there's any way
given,
we
right,
can
right.
get some target mm-hmm. in mind right. before mm-hmm. 7 o'clock, I don't know if we can.
Right. Right.
If you feel comfortable saying, you know, almost 20,000 or something. Mm-hmm. I just don't know what that number is.
You might offer the 3,000 to 4,000 typically that a survey would. Yeah, so that'd be 30% here.
Yeah.
The guy who did the survey could tell you exactly how much.
To see it.
He does.
Okay.
I already spoke with him. So.
I'd be concerned about coming up with a specific
right.
number for his services.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay.
Are you hoping for a formal motion in that, or is that good, what we have consensus?
I think I just wanted to ensure that you did all of your deliberation here, and then you're there to answer questions, which you can certainly do, but not arrive at any new conclusions there. I'm sorry, I'm jumping ahead, and I shouldn't.
Roby.
Right. So CVS talks a lot about school choice and charter and the effects that it's having in Western Massachusetts particularly. And we had a presentation at the May meeting, the last meeting, that a lot of school committees in the state have been passing resolutions against lifting the cap on charter schools. It is a referendum question, number two, on the ballot this fall. And so I brought it back to you folks to ask if you have any interest in doing the same. Some school districts are also not passing resolutions, but instructing their state representatives that they are against lifting the cap in a more simple way. That doesn't really address the resolution, the referendum issue. So I don't know if anybody's interested in taking a more political stance than this committee usually does.
I'm not necessarily crazy about going down that path, but Hadley is such a central community to travel to, also between Amherst and Northampton, along the 91 corridor. It would be the place that something would set up if there was an interest for additional charter schools to establish themselves. Mm-hmm. So I think we should think about it carefully.
I think the biggest issue that comes up for people is the way that charter schools are funded, mm-hmm.
right.
and the impact that it has on local schools, and that it is public money that has no, it's not like public funds that are used in Hadley, where it has an elected board to oversee the use of the funds. It is privately overseen, for better or worse.
Well, and you know, also the way, my understanding of the reimbursement is that if you choice assumes there is an empty seat that needs to be filled in a classroom, and so the reimbursement and or outgoing is about $5,000, and with charter it is assumed you are creating a new seat, which gets you to the $12,000 formula. And in the well-established charter schools, we are no longer creating a seat. They're well-established charter schools. So I'm actually very comfortable saying we are not in support of removing the cap, because I think that's premature. What we need to do first as a state is to look at the reimbursement formula and determine if that is still fair to our K-12 public schools that, in my opinion, are being unfairly competed against on a per student basis. Mm-hmm. That was not very eloquent, but I hope you understood what I was trying to say.
I'd be interested in learning more. I need to get smarter on the issue, and it seems to tie into what we were talking about with those different accounts as well. So what's the timeline here? We have a bit of time.
November. Chris Capucci is one of the staff for the No on Two, and he has offered to come to our school committee meeting and provide us with more information. Would we want that for September? Would that be helpful?
Is there a Yes on Two person?
I believe,
I'm sure there is.
From editorials I've seen in the Boston Globe, I think yes, there is a Yes on Two. I don't know if there's a specific entity. Do any of
yes,
you know?
Yes, there is. I can't think of the name of it, but there is a specific.
It would just be good to offer the counterpoint if we're going to give the floor to one side of the argument. Given it is a ballot topic, that people are going to have their own right to vote how they want.
Yeah, I'd be interested in hearing that in September.
Okay. So we'll work on a no on two, yes on two.
So it sounds like Chris Capucci is somebody we could get for September, and I will identify, I'm sure through the Charter Schools Association, I'm certain I can identify somebody, or I'll contact CES, they may very well know too.
Is Chris Caputo in with the MTA?
No, he's working for No One Two. He was Paul Mark's aide, and Quint to works full-time on No One Two.
Can I ask a question just about the chart that shows the sending district of Hadley, the net district payment of $473,000 roughly,
yeah,
and the reimbursement shortfall of $70,000, almost $71,000. How is that intended to be read? Can you interpret that for us?
The reimbursement shortfall is we pay out, Judy, we pay out us money to charter schools. And the state reimburses us according to a very complicated formula for only some number of years while the child is in charter school. And then you get nothing. And the shortfall is what the difference is.
So
between
what the town pays out and what the state reimburses.
That's my understanding of what
And
that
is that for just a single fiscal year? Is that what this number represents?
Yes.
So we essentially lose 70,000 a year.
Yes, this is fiscal year 2016.
With the current charter school enrollment caps? Okay, I just wanted to make sure I was reading that correctly.
So that ties with the numbers Judy you gave?
It should, because this is on the DESE.
Yeah, Mark and I are just looking at this and we're unclear about the source of those numbers and what exactly that means.
So you have the first paragraph? Sorry, I just walked through the second page of Hadley. So it's DESE fiscal year 2016.
Okay.
So it's estimates of how much money each district will lose for fiscal year 16 based on the amount of Chapter 78 that's diverted.
Right.
Minus state. Okay. So one would assume that if the cap were lifted and there were more students that were able to go to charter schools, that our shortfall would be greater. Because we would continue that trend of receiving less than what we are paying.
Well, there would be ostensibly more charter schools.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And right now the Department of the Board of Education has control over charter school applications and has been more conservative in accepting applications than the charter school folks would like. And I think that the referendum would inhibit their ability to be the gatekeeper.
So the cap is not on the enrollment in these schools, it's on
the number of schools that can be offered. That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
Although in order to get more enrollment, to have an amendment to extend enrollment, so Pioneer Valley Chinese Immersion Charter School is looking to double their enrollment,
right,
they do have to apply for that. That's not something that they can do on their own, that then they have to be approved to expand. But this is looking at number of schools. And to your point, they have, I won't be able to quote the criteria, but the Board of Education has set up specific criteria about the number of schools that are allowed, the locations in which are allowed. It has to do with the performance of the schools in the area. So the trying to stay true to the original purpose, I believe, which was to introduce options and competition for students who are being underserved by the only options available to them. This would eliminate some of that and just introduce the concept of choice, just choice, regardless of whether or not choice is a solution to a perceived problem or the argument would be that choice in and of itself is an end that we should desire pro lifting the cap. And others, the board has typically said, no, choice should be a strategy for those people for whom the absence of choice has resulted in negative educational consequences.
Just one more question, because I'm trying to understand all this. When a student chooses to go to a charter school and they go out of district, do we have to pay?
Yes.
We do, whether they're in district or out of district. They go to a charter school outside of our school district.
Yes, yes.
Like South Hadley.
Yes, they're Hadley resident, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Right. And by 12K.
Right. 12K.
Yes.
Yeah, a lot more than school choice in New York, which is 5K.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
To the tune of a negative $70,000. Cost us this year.
The charter school reimbursement, and I'm not going to get this right, but the formula used to be that in the first year you get 100%. 8%, and the second year you get 80%, and it would drop off, and it only lasted for a few years, and then the entire tuition just came right off the town's money. There wasn't any business for that. So charter schools that have long spans and have a child for 12 years will end up busting the system.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. And to your point, Judy, as you said earlier, and the reimbursement is determined annually by the budget process. So similar to regional transportation and other things, the goal might be to fund at a particular level, but as Judy pointed out, FY17 is held flat at FY16 levels.
Okay. More in September, we hope.
Yep.
We will try.
Okay,
we need to, we're done with all the reports, but we have outstanding action items of 2016-17 calendar corrections.
Yes, it is very minor. We will also send something home on October 6th. I take responsibility for this error. On October 6th, the calendar you originally voted, and October 7th, it listed both of those days as half days, when in fact October 7th at Hopkins Academy only. This was for the makeup time for parent-teacher conferences. When in fact it should only be October 7th half day for Hopkins Academy only. So October 6th is a full day for students. Students will be very frustrated with my error. Parents will be very happy that they don't have to worry about children running about for a few hours.
And you need us to approve that. Anyone willing to make a motion?
Someone.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor of that minor correction?
Aye.
Thank you. And surplus Hopkins English Department.
Yes, we have a list, I believe, that was sent out separately to you of the English Department books that will be donated using the same method that we've used for library books. So the books are... either we have far too many copies or they're just not in the shapes that we would use, we want to distribute to the students.
Okay with people?
Mm-hmm.
Can I have a motion to that?
Motion to approve the surplus English Department book listing for donations.
Second.
Okay, all in favor of that?
Aye.
Thank you. I think we've done it.
Mm-hmm.
Although we have time to see if our principals have anything to tell us about the opening of the school year.
I'm looking forward to getting back with the kids more than anything else. I mean, it was wonderful today to get the staff back, so you get a good chunk of your world back together when the faculty comes back. And we'll have one more day together, and then we'll already be sick of each other. So that's why we have to add the kids back.
Nice.
But it's been nice to see the number of students who have been around already into the fall, doing a number of different things, including the work that was done by the peer mentors in the night, that the new student orientation evening last Wednesday night. So, and also very appreciative to the athletic boosters and Mr. Sednick for the motivational speaker that they brought to the school. Which occurred last Wednesday night as well. So.
You're a very shiny school, too.
What's that?
You're a very shiny school.
Yeah.
It's always shiny before the kids start stepping on it again.
Mr. Mish and his team have done a phenomenal job. Mary Tanner.
Yes, they have.
Stanley Nigella, Diane Zach, and then over the summer also Christopher Olson worked with us over the summer. The job they did in getting to everything in this building has been incredible, and also Mike Duffy has done a remarkable job with a huge amount of stuff on his plate of getting us all set up and ready to go for the school year, so we're very appreciative.
I'm eager for the beginning of school, obviously. It's all new to me, but many of the teachers have been, almost all of them have been in throughout the month of August, setting up rooms, getting things ready, so it feels like we are ready to go. Today we had a great professional development on mental health, and many of the staff members attended that, so that was a great way to come together and discuss that important topic and get information with regards to that. And last Friday, the PTO sponsored MERSH, which was new to me, end of summer, beginning of school, and that was well attended, and it was very hot, so my, those cones were like milkshakes. By the time. they were literally pouring them into cups and giving them to kids to drink because it was so warm last Friday. But we are ready to go, and our custodial staff also has the building in great shape, so we're very grateful of that.
Awesome. We did, if I'm glad you brought that up, Dr. Wickman, we have over 60 staff members who have elected to receive national mental health first aid certification. So they are sitting in 8 hours of training from today going into tomorrow. They will receive certification similar to, think about CPR. If you see someone in crisis, what can I do to help care for them and keep them in a good space until additional help is available for them. So not only do they receive professional development for that, but as I said, they'll be certified. That certification is good for 3 years. And I am extraordinarily grateful that the vast majority of staff have voluntarily participated. And it was voluntary given the fact that 8 hours is a lot to give up in the first 2 days of school when you're trying to set up your classroom and prepare for students.
Madam Chair, can I make a quick comment about the buildings? You know, the custodial staff and the school committee should be commended. When we applied for the renovation grant, it was because they maintained the school. And then later it was changed to a core grant. We lost some of that. I wish our other municipal buildings were maintained the way the schools are, but they're not. We've got problems there, and the school has been outstanding maintaining their buildings, and they should be commended for it.
I will say that as Mr. Misch, and that certainly the school committee and funding everything that's necessary to make that happen, but that is Mr. Misch and all of our custodial staff. They really are fantastic.
I thought of one outstanding issue. So Heather reminded us via email to Paul and I that an outstanding issue is the grading of the softball field, and we had and the height of the backstop. And we had kind of put that off in hopes that we would get significant CPA funds that we would need to fix that problem. But now that we're going for a request for design and engineering, we need to get that on the list to have a conversation with Jeff Misch about whether we can figure out what to do about that.
So my sense is that would be part of the new design, assuming, say, we get the funding to go forward, you would factor that in, and maybe we prioritize that. We had been putting that off to the second or third phase. Mm-hmm. Given the need, maybe we'd find a way to make that part of the first phase. Mm-hmm. And maybe there's something that we actually start breaking ground
right
in the spring.
Yes. So.
And they've seen the original proposal going over that. I haven't didn't contact them about this one, given that it's just about design work.
Just a note about the height of the backstop. I don't know what the range. I don't know what solution specifically we've been looking at, but we've been on the tournament circuit this summer. As you know, my son plays a lot of baseball. So in Long Island, they use nets, like above. So rather than actually building up a lot of infrastructure, they have these very wonderfully sort of strung up nets that allow you to catch that pop fly and have it come down. So it might be worth looking at.
Sure.
It might be less expensive.
Okay.
All right, everyone going to be here for September 26th? We have a quorum, we think? Look at you people, you non-traveling people.
I might not be in town.
Okay.
What we have the schedule for the CES meeting, so you're going to be able to make the September meeting? That's the 28th. If you're not, I can go. But
it would be great if you could go. I think I will be in India.
Well, yes, I probably get difficult to even touch him.
I'll put that on.
So 5:30 on the 26th?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn.
Thank you.
Oh,
I need
motion.
Thank you. We've done it. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for coming. Happy school year.